Hello students, my name is Miss Benedicta Comba from the Faculty of Science, Technology and Environmental Studies. Welcome to OEV 107, General Biology. So this video will cover two main parts. The first one will discuss the protozoans, and then the second part will focus on kingdom plantae. So let's begin with the protozoans. The name protozoa comes from two words. The first one is proto, which means primitive, and the second one is zoa, which means animal. So protozoa means animals, organisms which are primitive to animals. So the protozoans belong to the kingdom, which is called kingdom Protista. The characteristics of protozoans. So they are unicellular, that means they have only one cell, and all their life processes occur inside a single cell. So since they have only one cell, they often rely on other organisms for necessities. They are also eukaryotic, their cells are eukaryotic, and they have nucleus and other membrane bound organelles. So here are the two examples of protozoans. This is the structure of a eubula, and this is the paramecium. So let's look at the parts. The structure of eubula consists of the flagellum. This is the long tail-like structure that helps this organism in movement. And this is the stigma. This is nucleus, and this is the chloroplast, this is the pericarp, and this is the contractile vacuum, and this is the nucleus, this is nucleolus, this is the nucleus, and this is the reservoir. So we can see the chloroplast in the eubula. This is chloroplast contains a green pigment called the chlorophyll, and therefore it is also capable of manufacturing its food. It can carry out the process of photosynthesis because the chlorophyll is able to trap light energy from the sun and use it during the process of photosynthesis. So another example is the paramecium, and the structures, the parts are an anterior contractile vacuum and the cytoplasm, micronucleus, macronucleus, cytoplot, posterior contractile vacuum, the food vacuum, the cell wall, orogluven, food vacuum, and we have this tiny hair-like structures which are called the cilia. Also, these help the organisms in movement. It helps the paramecium in the movement. So there are different types of vacuum. There is contractile vacuum and food vacuum. The two parts, the contractile vacuum in protozoans, for example, in organisms, protozoans that live in aquatic habitats, the contractile vacuum helps in osmoregulation, and the food vacuum helps in storing food. So there are two types of vacuums, the contractile vacuum and the food vacuum. They play two different roles in protozoans. So these are two examples, but there are other protozoans which we will discuss in the next slides. So, locomotion. Locomotion in protozoans can take three forms. It can be by the use of cilia, which are short hair-like structures that, what we have already seen in paramecium, and the flagella, which is the long tail-like structures. A good example is the eubula, which we have seen in the previous slide, and the pseudopodia. The pseudopodia is the extension of the cell body. The pseudopodia is also called feclins, and it is found in amoebas. So locomotion in protozoans can be by cilia or flagella or pseudopodia. Reproduction. Reproduction in protozoans can either be sexual or asexual. The asexual reproduction involves binary fission. This is the cytoplasmic division which follows mitosis and results in producing two organisms, and that's why it is called binary. Also, budding is also a form of asexual reproduction that is exhibited by certain protozoans. And another one is multiple fission. Multiple fission or schizogon, this is a cell or organism split into many new cells or organisms, and that's why it is called multiple. Multiple means many. An organism splits into many parts, and each one grows into an independent organism. In binary fission, an organism divides in two parts. Then, reproduction. This diagram summarizes the asexual reproduction that occurs in protozoans. For example, the first line here shows the reproduction. This is binary fission, which occurs in flagellated protozoans. For example, the trypanosoma. This is the causative organism or causative agent of sleeping sickness. And this is the euglena. So binary fission can either occur longitudinally, where an organism dividing to produce two independent organisms. So this occurs, binary fission occurs in flagellated protozoans. But also binary fission, also budding, this is the cytoplasmic protrusion of the cell body. For example, with the nuclei can divide into two parts, and then it forms the protrusion, which later on divides from the mother cell, and therefore results into a new organism. And then macrophage, mitosis of macrophage occurs, which lead to the formation of different parts. Normally, many parts, an organism splits into many parts. So, like what we see here. And this macrophage is common in Plasmodia. Plasmodia is a causative agent of malaria. So this is the summary of asexual reproduction in protozoa. So we have binary fission, which occurs in flagellated protozoans. We have budding, and then we have multiple fission, which occurs in Plasmodium. Then we move to sexual reproduction or conjugation. So the sexual reproduction or conjugation occurs in paramecia. So in this diagram, the prospective partners meet. Because this is sexual reproduction, there must be two parents, normally the male and the female parents. So in the first part, the prospective partners must meet, and therefore the partners must come together, and usually in the surface of their oral depressions. So the two cells undergo cytoplasmic fusion. Each partner's micronucleus undergoes meiosis. So in the second part, after the two partners of conjugation meet, they at the surface of their oral depression, they exchange their nucleus. And in paramecium, which is the protozoa which reproduce by conjugation, has two types of nucleus, the micronucleus and the macronucleus, which are the two types. So, of the two types, only the micronucleus is involved in conjugation. So, the third part, the two cells are the most cytoplasmic fusion, and each partner's micronucleus undergoes meiosis 1. So, after meiosis 1, the cell divides, and it leads to the formation of 4 haploid nucleus, which later on 3 degenerates, and then they move to the next part where the cell starts to divide until it forms the two partners separate, and then it moves the cell undergoes the mitosis, formation of independent organisms. So this is the conjugation which occurs in protozoans, and normally the specifically for paramecium. Then we move to habitats. A habitat is where an organism can be found. So protozoans can be found in various habitats. The first one is aquatic habitat, which is found, some protozoans can be found in freshwater, while others can be found in freshwater. Another type of habitat is the moist soil. Some protozoans can be found in moist soils. For example, the upper layer of the soil can include about 40,000 species. And the last habitat is some protozoans can be found in body tissues of plants and animals. Nutrients. So the protozoans obtain nutrients directly from the environment. Oxygen, potassium, and other dissolved substances pass through the cell membrane by diffusion. So diffusion is the movement of materials from the region of high concentration to that region with low concentration. So some protozoans engulf plant food particles through phagocytosis. For example, the amoeba obtain particles by phagocytosis. Relationship in protozoans, the association between the in relationship in protozoans, we look at the association between two organisms. So the first is the parasitism. Parasitism is the relationship between two organisms, normally the parasite and the host. And in such relationship, normally one organism, which is the parasite, benefits, while the other organism, the host, is harmed. So in parasitism, the parasite can obtain food but also shelter from the host. Communitarism. In communitarism, there is the relationship between two organisms in which one organism benefits and the other organism does not benefit and is not harmed, and therefore it remains neutral. And the last one, mutualism. This is the relationship between two organisms in which one organism benefits, and mutualism is the relationship between two organisms in which both organisms benefit from such relationship. So all these three types of relationship can be found in protozoans. Classification. Protozoans are classified according to the method of movement. So based on the method of movement, protozoans can be classified into 3 phyla. The first one is phylum Saccomastigophora, which is further divided into 2 subphyla. Subphylum Mastigophora and subphylum Saccodina. And then the next phylum is phylum Apicomplexa. And the last one is phylum Ciliophora. So these are the 3 phyla of Kingdom Protista. phylum Saccharomastigophora. So this phylum consists of about 18,000 species, and this is the largest protozoan phylum. So this phylum Saccharomastigophora is the largest in all in the kingdom Protista. The characteristics. The members of phylum Saccharomastigophora can either be unicellular, that means they can have only one cell, or they can exist in colonies. Their locomotion is either by flagella or pseudopodia or both. So there are certain protozoans under phylum Saccharomastigophora that can move by flagella, others can move by pseudopodia, and others can move by both flagella and pseudopodia. They are autotrophic, that means there are certain species that can carry the process of photosynthesis, that means they can make their own food. Others are saprozoic or heterotrophic. Those which cannot make their own food, they depend on other organisms for food. They have single type of nucleus, and usually they reproduce sexually. Subphylum Mastigophora. This subphylum consists of about 2,500 species. They move by the use of the flagella. The least complex, these are the least complex of protozoa because movement requires limited coordination. So most of the members of subphylum Mastigophora are parasites. And examples, good examples of members of subphylum Mastigophora are the trypanosoma, which causes sleeping sickness, and Eumena. Subphylum Saccharomastigophora. So, in organisms that belong to this subphylum Saccharomastigophora, they gather food by pseudopodia. So we have already seen that pseudopodia is used in movement, but under this phylum, pseudopodia has another function. It is used in gathering food. So pseudopodia plays two functions, one for movement and another for gathering food. They move by an extended part of the cytoplasm and cell membrane called pseudopodia. Some have hard outer shell of calcium carbonate, and pseudopodia extends through holes in a shell. So they have shells of calcium carbonate, and through which the pseudopodia extend. Another phylum is phylum Apicomplexa. The characteristics of the members of phylum Apicomplexa. So all of the members of phylum Apicomplexa are parasites. They have apical complex for penetrating the host cells. Because they are parasites, it means they depend on other organisms for food and also shelter. So they have an apical complex which helps them to penetrate the host cells. They have a single type of nucleus, and usually they do not have cilia nor flagella. Their life cycle includes asexual and sexual stages. So this is the diagram that represents the members of phylum Apicomplexa, and this is the apical complex, which is composed of parts such as the coloring, the subpeculiar, subpellicular microtubules, the microlings, the rods, and micropores. So these parts together form the apical complex, and this is the one that helps the members of phylum Apicomplexa, because they are parasites, the apical complex helps them to penetrate the host of the cell, the cells of the host. And also, another unique feature about the Apicomplexa, their cells have certain parts that resemble a typical eukaryotic cell. They have structures such as Golgi bodies, the nucleus, endoplasmic reticulum, the mitochondria, and the posterior ring. So this, they have certain ingredients that resembles the cells of typical eukaryotic cell. Phylum-coelophore. The characteristics. They have cilia for locomotion and generation of feeding currents of water. So the cilia, apart from helping in the movement, it helps also in the generation of the feeding currents of water. So they have relatively rigid pellicle and more or less of a fixed shape. So the rigid pellicle, also when we are discussing the conjugation in Paramecium, we saw the point where the two patterns of conjugation exchange their pellicle. So the nuclei, which are involved in conjugation, pass through the pellicle. And this is also the characteristic. Their pellicle are relatively rigid and more or less fixed. They have distinct cytostome. The cytostome is the mouth structures, and therefore it helps the protozoans and the phylum Coelophora to obtain the materials from the environment. They also have dimorphic nuclei. That is, typically they have large micronuclei and the small micronuclei. So the small micronuclei, this is the one that helps in conjugation. So the summary of the protozoans. So we said there are three phyla and kingdom Protista, and this is phylum Saccharomastigophora, which is further divided into subphylum Mastigophora, and subphylum Saccharina. So in subphylum Mastigophora, examples of organisms under this subphylum are Gomianus and Trypanosome, and also under phylum Saccharina we have Amoeba and Pinaceophora. So this is the summary of the protozoans. The three phyla are shown and representative members under each phylum. So these are just few examples, and we can see the, for example, this Trypanosoma and its structures, the flagella, the kinetoplast, the nucleus, undulating membrane, but also we have the amoebas with its pseudopodium, the endoplasm, the nucleus, the food vacuum, contractile vacuum, but also we have members of phylum Coelophora. These are the cilia. These are the cilia, hair-like structures which help in movement but also in generating feeding currents of water. The mucocavities and the undulating membranes. And the last one is the phylum Apicomplexa, which has two phases, the sexual and asexual phase. So we are still discussing the, we are still summarizing the protozoans. So here in this column we have phylum, then common name, locomotion, and examples. For example, the phylum Saccharina, the common names are called saccharines, and their locomotion, they move by pseudopodia. And a good example is Amoeba. And another phylum is phylum Coelophora, and organisms that belong to phylum Coelophora are commonly known as ciliates because of the cilia, which is used in locomotion. A good example of ciliates are Paramecium, the hair-like structures which are distributed all over its body are called cilia, and they are used for locomotion. So another phylum is phylum Saccharomastigophora, and these are commonly known as zooflagellates, and they move by flagella, and a good example is Trypanosoma or Giardia. And the last one is phylum Apicomplexa. These are commonly known as sporozoans, and they do not show any type of movement in adult form, and that's why we say they do not have cilia nor flagella. In adult forms, they do not show any form of movement. And a good example is Plasmodium. So this is the end of the first part. We move to the second part, which is the kingdom plantae. So characteristics of kingdom plantae. Remember, the plants are multicellular and they have cells which are specialized to form tissues and organs. So they are multicellular means they have many cells, and different cells in plants are specialized to perform different functions. So these cells are specialized to form tissues and organs. So a group of cells form tissues, group of tissues form organs, and different organs form systems. They contain chlorophyll A, B, and carotenoids. So the plants have chlorophyll. They have chlorophyll A and B, but also they have carotenoids. So this chlorophyll is a green pigment that helps the plants to trap light energy from the sun and use it in the process of photosynthesis. So they store food as starch. This is another characteristic. So after photosynthesis, the food that is formed is stored as starch. They have cellulose in their cell wall. So they have cell wall which is made up of cellulose. They show alternation of generation. The alternation of generation means that the plants, some plants show alternation of generation. That means the two generations alternate to complete a life cycle of a plant. For example, there is gametophyte generation where plants produce gametes, and the sporophyte generation where the plants produce spores. They have sex organs with an outer layer of non-reproductive cells which prevents the secretion of developing embryos. So they also have sex organs which have, they are inside and outer cells which prevent the secretion. So in case of an embryo which is developing, the secretion of developing gametes and embryos. So the plant life cycle. We have seen in the previous slides that one of the characteristics of members of kingdom plantae is that they show alternation of generation. So this shows the plant life cycle with the two generations, the gametes, the gametosporophyte generation and the gametophyte generation alternating to complete the life cycle of a plant. So if we begin from any point, that in gametophyte generation, the gametes are produced which are involved in sexual reproduction. So for sexual reproduction to occur, there must be gametes, normally from the male and the female parents. So during gametophyte generation, the gametes are produced, the eggs and sperm. So after they unite, the fusion of the egg and sperm leads to the formation of a zygote. So the zygote grows into a sporophyte generation. So once the zygote which has been formed during the gametophyte generation, it grows into the sporophyte generation. So during sporophyte generation, the spores are produced, which later on germinate, and once they reach a favorable environment, they germinate, and the spores grows also into the gametophyte generation. So this is the cycle, the process continues, and that's why it is called the life cycle shows the alternation of generation. The two generations, the sporophyte and the gametophyte generation, alternate to complete the life cycle of a plant. Then we move to plant classifications. So we have bryophytes. The bryophytes, which belong to phylum Hepatophyta, we have the mosses, which belong to phylum Bryophyta, and the hornworms, which belongs to phylum and to sterile to fighter. And another group, the seedless vascular plants. They are commonly known the seedless vascular plants because they do not produce seeds, but they have vascular systems or vascular bundles. So under seedless vascular plants, we have different phyla. And the first one, a good example, is the whisk fern, which belongs to phylum Psilotophyta, the crab roses under phylum Lycoponophyta, the hostels, which belong to phylum Inquisitophyta, and the ferns, which belong to phylum Pteridophyta. So this is plant classifications. But also, we have gymnosperms. Gymnosperms, under gymnosperms, we have conifers, which belong to phylum Pinophyta. We have cycads, which belong to phylum Cycadophyta. And we have maidenhair trees, which belongs to phylum Lithophyta. And the netophytes, which belong to phylum Netophyta. And the last group is the angiosperms. Angiosperms, these are flower-producing plants. They produce flowers. They belong to phylum Magnoliophyta. Under phylum Magnoliophyta, we have two classes. The first one is class Magnoliopsida, which are commonly called the dicots, and the class Liniopsida, which are called commonly known as the monocots. So in flowering plants, there are two classes, Magnoliopsida and Liniopsida, the monocots and the dicots. Then we move to bryophytes. Bryophytes consist of three groups, the hornworts, the liverworts, and the mosses. Characteristics. They lack vascular tissues, so they do not have vascular tissues like other plants, which have vascular tissues. They do not have true roots, stems, or leaves. So, unlike other plants, the bryophytes do not have true roots, stems, or leaves. They show alternation of generation, with the gametophyte generation being the dominant generation. So in bryophytes, they show alternation of generation, but the gametophyte generation in bryophytes is the dominant generation. So this is the life cycle of a bryophyte, and we begin with this structure here. This is the moss plant, and it has structures such as center, and this is the capsule. Inside the capsule there is a sporangium, and this here is the foot. So the sporangium, meiosis, in mature sporophyte, meiosis occurs in this sporangium. So once it matures, it breaks up, and it releases spores. The spores are released into the environment, and therefore they develop into independent plants. So for example here, the spores germinate to form a bud, and later on which develops into the male gametophyte. But as we have already seen that the bryophyte, the two phases, the sporophyte and the gametophyte generations alternate, it means in gametophyte, during gametophyte generation, there are two gametes, the male and the female gametes, which must fuse in order to form a zygote. So the spores develop independently into a male and a female gametophyte. So this is the male gametophyte. And if the male gametophyte has antheridia, which inside it contains the sperms. While the other plant, which grew independently, forms a female gametophyte, developed into a bud, which later on led to the formation of a mature female gametophyte. So the female gametophyte contains archegonia. Archegonia is the female part in bryophytes. And inside the archegonia, the egg is formed inside the archegonia. So the sperms are formed inside the antheridia in male gametophytes. And in female gametophytes, the egg is formed in archegonia. So there has to be a certain way where the sperms can reach the egg so that fertilization can occur in order for an offspring to be formed. So these bryophytes normally are found in areas of moist habitat, or mostly during the rain season. So during raindrop, the sperms are released from the antheridia, and therefore they travel until they reach the egg inside the archegonium. So fertilization occurs within the archegonium in the female gametophyte. So once the fertilization has occurred, the zygote develops inside the archegonium and later on develops into an embryo. And then an embryo develops into the young sporophyte plant with the calyptra, and the young sporophyte plant develops into a female gametophyte plant, which contains again the capsule, seta, wood, and the rhizoids. So this is the life cycle of a bryophyte. The two generations, the sporophyte generation and the gametophyte generation, alternate to complete the life cycle of a bryophyte. But as I said earlier, in bryophytes, the gametophyte